Hello friends, welcome back to All About Structure and Analysis and Design. So in this video, we will see how to design a rectangular isolated footing of uniform thickness. So in one of the videos, I have shown you the detailed steps how to design a square isolated footing. So you can find the link in the description box and also in the I button at the top of this video. So today's task is to design a rectangular footing. So this is a given problem. Design a rectangular isolated footing of uniform thickness for a RC column bearing a vertical load of 600 kN having size 400 mm into 600 mm. So the column size they have given is 400 into 600 mm and the load coming from that column is 600 kN. And the SBC of the soil is given as 120 kN per meter square and the materials used are M20 grade of concrete and the grade of steel is Fe415. So this is the given data. From this you have to design a rectangular footing. So the first step in the RCC problem, what we have to do is you have to write down the given data. So the given data, column size 400 mm into 600 mm. So next given is a load that is 600 kN. And SBC is 120 kN per meter square. And also the materials they have given. The concrete is denoted as FCK, that is 20 Newton per mm square. And Fy as 415 Newton per mm square. So this is the given data. So before moving on to this problem, I will show you the footing of design of footing, how we are going to proceed. So this is the sketch of this footing. So this is the direction B, the dimension B, and this is L, and this is A, the size of the column A and size of the column B. So we are going to follow this pattern for a section for one-way shear, punching shear. I will explain you how we will proceed in this problem. So this you have to remember this figure. So this is very important to proceed the further calculations. So now first you have to fix up the size of the footing. So the step one for this particular problem, step one will be fixing the size of the footing. So if you have seen my previous video, we have done assuming the self weight of footing equal to 10% of the superimposed load. So the size of footing, so assume self weight of footing equal to 10% of superimposed load. Okay, so that is nothing but WS equals to 10% of this 600 kN. So it comes around 60 kN. So now therefore total load equals to W plus this we will denote it as W is equals to WL plus WS. So this was live load, which is coming, this is 600 plus 60. So this total load W is equals to 660 kN. So this you can make a box. Now area required of footing. So area we find out by taking W, that is total load, divided by SBC. So total load was 660 kN and SBC given is 120 kN per meter square. So it comes around 5.5 meter square. So the area of the footing which we are going to provide is having 5.5 meter square. Let us take B by L ratio. Okay, we take it as a 40 by 60, which comes around 2 by 3. So this we have to take, and therefore B is equals to 2 by 3 into L. So this L we are going to move to this side and we are going to calculate. Now area is equals to B into L. From this we know A. Okay, this is A is equals to B is 2 by 3 into L and into this L. Okay, next we have to substitute. Area we have got 5.5 meter square. So 5.5 is equals to 2 by 3 L square. Okay, so this is again done. 5.5 is equals to 0.67 L square. Therefore L square is equals to 5.5 divided by 0.67. So it comes around 8.2. So next L is equals to square root of 8.2. So this comes around L is equals to 2.86 meter. Now when we have got this, it is very easy to find out B. So now B is equals to, we had done 2 by 3 into L. Therefore B is equals to 2 by 3 into 2.86. just now we have got the L value. Therefore this B comes out to be 1.90 meters. So this is the width of that particular footing. Number, therefore provide footing of size 2 meter into 3 meter. So this is the size of our footing. So the first step is over. Now next step, step number 2, is to calculate net upward pressure. Net upward pressure for that particular footing, and it is denoted as P naught. So P naught is equals to W, the total load 660 which we have calculated, divided by B into L. So W is 660 and this is 2 into 3. So P naught comes out to be 110 kilonewton per meter square. So this is another important value which we'll be using for the next steps. So this is the step number 2. So now next, step number 3. Now you have to calculate the depth of footing on the basis of bending moment. So the step will, step 3 will be depth of footing. So now bending moment about section XX. About section XX. So to, so this is the section XX. So bending moment along this section XX we are going to find out. And the bending moment is given by, is given by this formula. M1 equals to P naught B divided by 8 L minus A the whole square. So suppose this is your footing. So this is column and this is your rectangular footing. Okay. So now what you are going to find out is bending moment about section XX. So the section was cut here. So this is your XX section. It is nothing but a cantilever section. So this is given, or this is fine, the distance between this particular points is half L minus A. How you have to come back to again this particular figure. So this is section XX. So the total length was L. So this is exactly half you have to do. So when you come to that particular half, so half L minus A. So this column also you are deducting, the size of this column also you are deducting. So the only distance remaining is half L minus A. So this is half L minus A. Now what you are going to do from this soil, okay, the soil, the footing is resting on that particular soil, and this will have a net upward pressure which we have calculated now, just now. P naught, that is 110 kilonewton per meter square. So this will be acting like this. P0 into B, correct, for that particular width B. So now what you have to do, assume it as a cantilever section. So this will be your XX and this will be your P0B acting at a distance X. Now X will be what, half L minus A. Now the bending moment for this particular cantilever is given by P0B into X acting at a distance X by 2. So P0B into X is half L minus A, and this half as it is again into X is half L minus A. So this entire thing M becomes P0B by 8, correct? These two will become 8 and L minus A the whole square. So this is nothing but this M1 formula for the section XX. So this is how you calculate the bending moment equation for the section XX. Okay, I hope you have understood this explanation. So now what you have to do, you have to just substitute the values of P0, B and L, A, and you will be getting directly the bending moment value. So we will substitute here. So M1 is equals to P0 is 110, B is 2 divided by 8, L is 3 minus 0.6 the whole square. So A is taken as 600 mm and it is 0.6 meters. So now you will be getting this value, M1 equals to 158.4 kilonewton per kilonewton meter. So 158.4 kilonewton meter. So now M1U, the ultimate moment you have to calculate, and it is done by multiplying factor of safety 1.5. So 1.5 into 158.4, so this will come around 237.6 kilonewton meter. So this is your ultimate moment M1U. Now similarly, bending moment about section YY. So now what you have to do, similar bending moment you have to find out for the section YY, which is horizontal. So this half B minus B will come into picture. So the formula becomes for this M2, we will denote it as M2 for the section YY. M2 is P0L by 8 B minus B the whole square. So now you have to just substitute again here. P0 was 110, L is 3 divided by 8, B is 2, and this small b, the column size is 0.4 the whole square. So M2 becomes 105.6 kilonewton meter. Now you have to find out ultimate moment, that is M2U, by multiplying factor of safety 1.5. 1.5 into 105.6, and this M2U you will get around 158.5 kilonewton meter. So this is how you have to calculate moment two times. M1U, obviously that was 237, which is greater than M2U. So therefore we will be using M1U moment to calculate the depth of the footing. So now M1U equals to 0.138 FCK B D square. Now, because that M1U was along the direction B, that's why we have taken here B. If suppose M2U was greater, then M2U will be on this side, and in place of B, we will be taking L if M2U was greater than M1U. But in this case, M1U is greater, that's why this dimension B we have taken to find out the effective depth of that particular footing. So now d square, so this d square, so this d we are going to find out. So d square will be M1U divided by 0.138 FCK B. So just substitute here the values. The M1U was 237.6 kilonewton meter. We will be calculating, converting it into newton millimeter. So by multiplying into 10 raised to 6. So this 0.138 FCK is 20, and this B is 2000 millimeters. So that becomes in under the square root 237.6 into 10 raised to 6 divided by 0.138 into 20 into 2000. Correct. So this is the way you have to work out, and this will come around 207.5. So this is the calculated depth by taking the into consideration the bigger moment. So now we will take approximately 210 mm. Provide 50 mm cover. So which is the minimum for this particular footing concept. 50 mm cover. Therefore, D will be D plus D dash. D we have taken 210 plus this 50, which will become 260 mm. But due to shear considerations, if you have seen my previous video, also there I have explained, and due to shear considerations, what we are doing, this D will not be sufficient to cater the one-way shear and two-way shear. So that's why we will be directly increasing here the value of effective depth, and then we will check the one-way shear and two-way shear. So now what we will do is, due to shear consideration, one sentence I will write here. Due to shear checks, we will be increasing the D value. Okay. Therefore, adopt D is equals to 400 mm. Okay. Cover we will be giving the same, D dash equal to 50. Therefore, overall depth will be 400 plus 50, which is 450 mm. So now for all the calculations, we will be taking the D value as 400 mm. So now step number 4, to calculate area of reinforcement. Area of reinforcement. Now it means there are two moment values for rectangular footing. So that's why you have to calculate two times area of reinforcement. That will be AST1 and AST2. So now AST1 will be for moment 1 along XX direction. That is the formula is 0.5 FCK by FY 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6 m1u divided by fck b d square into bd. So this is along xx direction. So just substitute 0.5 into 20 divided by 415, 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6. it is 237.6 into 10 raised to 6. We are converting it into Newton millimeter. FCK is 20. This B is 2000 and D is 400. 400 we are taking in the calculations, not 210. Remember. So this 400, B is 2000 and this is 400. So the value comes of AST1 is 1723. Millimeter square. So this is the area of reinforcement. So now you have to check the percentage, how much this percentage is. So P is equals to AST1 divided by BD into 100. Just substitute the values. So AST1 is 1723 divided by 2000 into 400 into 100. So this P percentage will become 0.21%. So this is the percentage of steel for this AST1. P we have got 0.21%, and minimum AST for the footing for HYSD grade is 0.12%. So it is satisfying this criteria also. Therefore, P is greater than 0.12%. Therefore, okay, and we can proceed. Now, using 12 mm 5 bars, we will use 12 mm diameter bars for this footing. So you have to calculate the small AST, that is pi by 4 d square. So d is this area of steel. It comes around 113 millimeter square. Now, number of bars equals to AST 1 divided by this AST. So 1723 divided by 113, it is 15.24 bars, which is approximately 16 bars. Now you have to find out spacing. Therefore, spacing equals to this for that particular width and divided by number of bars. So this B is 2000, number of bars is 16, so it will come 125 mm. Therefore, provide 12 mm 5 at 125 mm center to center spacing for that particular width B. Now, similarly, AST 2. This AST 2 you have to find out. And the formula remains same again, 0.5 FCK by FY, 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6. Now, M2U divided by FCK for the span L. And now this will change, D1 square, L into D1. How it will change, I will explain. So this will be your footing depth, right? And now whatever AST1 you have provided will be like this. And your effective depth means this D till here, middle portion, right? And above this, the next reinforcement will be coming. So now this D1, whichever I have written in the previous formula, is this particular distance from center of this reinforcement. This will be D1, sorry. This will be D1. So now what we'll be doing, this D1 will be D minus 12. So this is 400 minus 12. So D1 will be 388 mm. Understood, right? So this we have used 12 mm bar. So this middle means this 6 mm will remain, and this further 6 mm. So this bar also will be using 12 mm only, and this half will become 6. So 6 plus 6, 12. Otherwise, what you can do for simplicity, 400 minus 12 by 2 minus 12 by 2. So this also comes around 388 mm. So this is the concept behind D1. So now you have to substitute in that AST formula. So AST2 will be 0.5 into 20 divided by 415, 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6. This M2U was 158.64 into 10 raised to 6 divided by 23,000, and now this D1, 3,000 into 388. So this works out to be 1155 mm square. So this is the second AST we have found out. Now provide 12 mm 5 bars . So small AST will be 113 mm square, same as previous case. Then number of bars will be AST2 divided by AST. So 1155 divided by 113, you will be getting 12.36 bars, approximately 13 bars. Now then spacing is equals to L divided by number of bars. So L is 3000 divided by this 13, you'll be getting 235 mm. Therefore provide 12 mm, 5 bars at 235 mm, center to center. Now next two important steps, that is check for one way shear and two way shear. So step number 5 will be check for one way shear. So for one way shear, critical section is located at a distance d from the face of the column. You can refer this figure again. So what it says, the critical section is located at a distance d from the face of the column. So this is your column A into B, and this is a distance d. So that's why I have drawn one again a line, dotted line, from this section XX, at section XX and section YY. So this two particular lines, so this section here, and this is the section which is for one way shear. So this is also known as beam shear also. So this is the location of this one way shear. So now again two shears will come along X direction and Y direction. So first we will find out along X direction. So Vx, we will denote it as Vx equals to P naught B half L minus A minus D. Understood? This is half L minus A, and again total this is half L minus A, and you are coming at a distance d. So this again d you are deducting. So this total distance will be half L minus A minus d into P naught b. So now just substitute. So Vx equals to 110, b is 2 meters, half L is 3 minus 0.6 minus 0.4. So now Vx equals to 176 kilonewton, right? So now Vux also we are going to find out by multiplying factor of safety 1.5, 176. So this will come 264 kilonewton. So similar way along Y direction, that is Vy. Vy equal to P naught L half B minus B minus D. So when you substitute here, 110 into 3, half 2 minus 0.4 minus 0.4. So Vy will be 132 kilo newton. So again you have to multiply it by 1.5. So Vy 1.5 into 132, so you will get 198 kilo newton. Now nominal shear stress. Nominal shear stress, that is page number 72 of IS 456 2000. Page number 72, IS 456 2000, that is tau V is equals to VU by BD. Page 72, IS 456. So tau V, the formula says, now this is greater, 264 is greater, therefore we will use Vux. So Vux divided by BD. This is 264 in Newton means into 10 raised to 3 divided by 3000 into 400. So this will come 0.33 Newton per mm square. Now you have to calculate design shear strength of concrete. So that will be the next line. Shear strength of concrete. So this is again given in page number 72 of IS 456-2000, design shear strength of concrete. So tau c k. So this k value is given below, and our depth is more than 300, so the k value will be 1, and tau c will be again calculated from this page number 73, table number 19 of IS 456-2000. So now this will be denoted as tau c dash. So tau c dash will be equals to k in tau c into k. K equals to 1 because depth is greater than 300 mm. So it is given on page number 72, you can find out. Okay, so then next, tau c for percentage of steel 0.21. Now tau c for P equals to 0.21 percentage. So if you have remembered, we have calculated percentage of steel along this B direction. So that percentage we are going to take, and we are going to find out the tau c. From page 73, so table number 19. So this is your page number 73, table number 19. So this is P here. So our P is 0.21, so it means it lies between 0.15 and 0.25, and the grade given is M20. So the value for 0.15 percentage is 0.28, and the value for 0.25 is the 0.36. So ours is 0.21, so we have to interpolate and we have to calculate the tau c value. So the table says 0.15, the value is 0.28, and for 0.25 the value is 0.36. now you have to interpolate. Tau c equals to the least value is 0.28, and the value is increasing, so it means we have to add it. 0.36 minus 0.28 divided by 0.25 minus 0.15 into the what value we are going to find out, that is 0.21 minus 0.15. So this tau c will be 0.328 newton per mm square. So tau v is greater than tau c. So this was 0.33. This is 0.328 greater than tau c. Therefore, sorry, one slight mistake I had made here. So this b is 2000, not 3000. Okay, so by mistake I have taken 3000. This is 2000. The value will remain same, 0.33. So just make a correction of that particular value. So this, what it suggests, the depth whatever you have provided. Initially the depth according to moment was 210 mm. So but due to shear considerations, what we had done, we have increased the depth to 400 mm. But now here, check for shear, when we were doing, we have found out that tau v is greater than tau c. So it means the whatever the depth we have provided, that is 400 mm, is insufficient to carry this one way shear check. So it means we have to provide slightly more depth than 400 mm. Why slightly more depth? Because this 0.33 value is very near to 0.328. so suppose if you are increase to this value around 410, so it might be sufficient for that particular depth, and it may give a shear check successful. So now for this case, what we can do is you can redesign this particular footing, or you can just mention here depth provided is not sufficient, therefore not safe in one way shear according to this examination problem. Otherwise you have to completely redesign the problem. Redesign means you have to again define the effective depth a greater value. But for now, we will conclude this as this tau v is greater than tau c, depth provided, that is 400 mm is not sufficient, and hence not safe in one way shear. So like this you can conclude. Step number 6 will be check for two-way shear. So for two-way shear, also known as punching shear, also known as punching shear, the section lies at a distance, d by 2 from face of the column. So you can have shown in this figure this punching shear. So this whatever rectangular with dotted line is the section for punching shear, and the distance is d by 2 from the face of the column from all the four sides. So this will be the section for punching shear, this rectangular dotted line. So now you have to find out first the perimeter. We will denote it as B0. We will denote it as B0, and it is A plus D plus B plus D into 2 times. So just substitute here, A value is 0.6 plus B is 0.4 plus B is 0.4 plus D is 0.4 into 2. Why 2 times? Because this is already 0.6, okay? This is already 0.6, and this is the D by 2, and D by 2, which is nothing but again 0.4. So this is one side. So into 2 I have done, because this is the another side. Similar way, 0.4 this B, and this is again 0.2. So this will be again 0.4 completely. And again 2 sides, 1, 2. So that's why I have multiplied it by 2. So this complete B0 will be 3.6 meters. So you have to be careful while calculating the perimeter of that particular punching shear perimeter. So now area ABCD. Area ABCD means this whole rectangle, this dotted line I have considered ABCD. So this area, complete area, you have to find out. So that will be 0.6 plus 0.4 into 0.4 plus 0.4. So this comes around 0.8 meter square. So punching shear now is calculated by P0 L into B minus area of that punching shear rectangle ABCD. So P0 again 110, L is 3 and B is 2 minus area is 0.8. So when you do this, so you will be getting, so I will denote it this as F, 572 kilonewton. So again you have to multiply it by 1.5. so this will be Fu equal to 1.5 into 572. So this comes around 858 kilonewton. Now from page 57, IS 456, clause number 31.6.2. so tau V will be Fu by B0 D. So here, if you go to page number 57, so this one, so page number 57, they have clearly mentioned the nominal shear stress will be V by V naught D. V means we have taken here Fu. So this formula you have to use and you have to find out the tau V value. So Fu was 858 into 10 raised to 3. So this B naught is 3.6 meters we have got. So we'll convert it into mm and this will be 400. So this tau V will be getting 0.595 Newton per mm square. So now permissible shear stress Ks tau C, page number 58. So similar way you have referred page number 57. So now you have to refer page number 58. So I'm taking this in inclined position. So when shear reinforcement is not provided, the calculated shear stress at the critical section shall not exceed Ks tau C. So this you have to refer. And the Ks value here they have mentioned 0.5 plus beta C. Beta C being the ratio of short side to long side of the column, and tau C 0.25 root of FCK for the limit state method. So this value they have given and you have to just work it out. So now Ks is equals to 0.5 plus beta C. So beta C is equals to ratio of short side to long side. So that is 400 mm divided by 600 mm. You'll be getting this value as 0.67. So now Ks is equals to 0.5 plus 0.67. You'll be getting 1.17. But the maximum value only is 1. So therefore adopt Ks equals to 1. Maximum is 1. So adopt Ks equals to 1. And tau C equals to 0.25 root of FCK. So this 0.25 root of 20. So you'll be getting 1.11 Newton per mm square. So now you have to substitute. So this Ks tau C value, Ks is 1, this is 1.11. So 1.11 Newton per mm square. Therefore tau V is less than Ks tau C. Therefore safe in two-way shear. Even though the footing is not safe in one-way shear, your footing or this particular footing is safe in two-way shear. But it doesn't mean that you have to design with the same effective depth, because obviously it will fail in one-way shear and it is not preferable to use these dimensions. So what you can conclude, but as the slab is not safe in one-way shear, footing depth has to be redesigned. So one small sentence here I will write down. But the slab is not safe in one-way shear. The footing depth has to be redesigned. Thank you, friends.